We would be honored if you would join us.
Welcome back, everybody, to the Bucs Planet podcast. And yes, we finally have came up with a name other than saying this is just my podcast. It is now the Bucs Planet podcast. I love the name. Like, this is a fantastic name, I think, for my podcast. But then again, I still want to know what you guys think. So comment down below. Say if you guys like the name or not. And the logo. I made the logo myself. I'm really proud of it. I like the direction. We finally have an identity, guys. Together, we are the Bucs Planet podcast. And you're probably asking, why is it the Bucs Planet? Well, I have a new identity for myself too, because recently I have bought a Darth Vader helmet and gotten my friend, Amelia Spicola, best friend, fantastic, shout out to her. She painted it for me, painted this big Bucs logo on it on both sides. It looks like a helmet. It looks so cool. So I am Buck Vader. That's who I am. And I needed my podcast to reflect this in a way. So I needed like a Star Wars space kind of Bucs combination, and Bucs Planet was the key. There's no Bucs Planet out there, but there is now. And that's who we are. Bucs Planet Podcast. I love the name. I'm really excited where this is going to be. And before we get into today's video, I just want to say that, you know, the season's going to be starting up soon. And I'm going to be covering my first ever regular season with the podcast, because again, this was created in January and there was no games when I made this because it was in the off season. So it'll be interesting to see what direction this goes in. However, I will still be doing film study on my Snapchat story. So if you guys want the film study too, you should be adding me on Snapchat at @Will_Neely on Snapchat. That's if you want the film study. I'm always going to go through here and talk about bad plays and stuff, but I'm not going to show it because I'm not that good with technology right now. But on Snapchat, I will record the plays. I will say what went wrong, what went right, and why it's good or bad. So again, if you want that extra coverage, which a lot of people do, a lot of people love my Snapchat stories. Some people like it better than the podcast. I don't know. Some people are weird like that, but this is something you should. So if you want the full Will Neely Bucs coverage, you should be subscribed to me on YouTube, and you should be adding me on Snapchat. These are things you should be doing if you want the full coverage. Now, again, you can just watch the videos, do whatever you want. I'm just saying. My full thing is Snapchat and here. And now we'll get into today's video. And it's obviously going to be about training camp. I was debating on doing this podcast for a while, ever since I came with the new logo and the new name and stuff. I've wanted to make this podcast because I did the change about a couple weeks ago. But I mean, I'm just going to be honest here. There is nothing to talk about. Like, seriously. Like, you're probably like, well, there's so much training camp stuff. Like, all these guys online and the newspaper and all blah, all they do is talk about training camp. Why can't you do that? Come on, guys. Look, I like to host intelligent Buccaneer fans on this account. Or football fans. I like to host intelligent NFL fans on this account. And all of you intelligent NFL fans should already know that everything, every report that comes out of training camp is probably 99% completely false. And you know this. Every year it's, oh, the defense is on fire. Look how good we're doing. That's completely fixed. Mike Smith fixed the defense. Winston has taken the step this year. And then it's just the same old crap on the field. Like, I really... It's a little, you know, derogatory, but I'm sorry. That's what it is. Like, you just know that it's just false. So I don't want to go on here and start saying, oh, this person's going to have a breakout season. He looks good in training camp. Because I'm not going to lie to you guys. I'm not like the other fake people out there that report on this and just completely lie to you guys and say that, you know, this person looks good, he's having a good season, blah, blah, blah. The defense looks great. Like, you just know that it's not. Like, we're starting to blitz more. Like, I've been to two training camps now, and I'm going to talk about what I saw. I'm not going to make any predictions because I'm not trying to just come out here and make predictions and lie to you people. I'm not trying to do that. I'm just going to say what I saw, what looked good and what looked bad. Because if you look at the newspaper, it all looked good. All the kickers are hitting 60-yard field goals. All the defense is blitzing. All the offense is, you know, blah, blah, blah. Man, I'm going to tell you what's going on in training camp. Okay, some of these people, they really don't know what's going on that well. I'm going to tell you what's going on because I've been to two now. One of them was a season ticket members exclusive. Very fun. Now, if you've been reading the newspaper or anything Bucs related, the one thing you'll read is the defense is heavily improved. And where have we seen this before? Oh, every other year. I mean, just last year I got this report. It's like Mike Smith fixed the defense. Quan Alexander's having all these one-on-ones with Mike Smith. And, you know, they're really starting to get to know each other. They actually understand the defense now. And then all the reports from the Tampa Bay Times, fake news, all the reports, they go, oh, the defense is going to have a breakout year. It's improved. And you just know that it's not. Like, you should be reading that from the intelligent fans out there. You should be reading that and saying, no, it's not. Because it's ridiculous how they keep saying that. You cannot make predictions this early in a season. And you can. You can do whatever you want to, technically. But you cannot have a qualified opinion of a prediction this early in the season. You can't. I mean, the year the Jaguars, a few years ago, when they went to the AFC Championship game, they were coming off of like a 3-13 season. Nobody knew they'd have that good of a season before. You just have to look at how the team actually plays in games. And after the first 3 or 4 weeks of the season, you kind of know what type of season it's going to be. Now, of course, there's exceptions, but for the most part, you know if it's going to be good or bad. And I know you're saying, oh, that's ironic, Will, because Bucs went like, you know, 2-1 and Fitzmagic and all those things first four games. Yeah, but you could see the cracks. You could start to see the cracks in the Pittsburgh game. And we all knew it wasn't sustainable. Look, you just cannot have a qualified opinion about how the season's going to be at this point. Seriously. We could be good. We actually could. We could be really bad, which is probably more likely, but who knows? And if you're using training camp as your evidence to why we'll be good or bad, that's not valid. That is not valid evidence. But I will say this. So the report on the defense looking good. Okay, they're not wrong reports. It's just when you say that the defense is going to be good this year because it looks good in training camp, it's just really not a good thing. It's just a stupid thing to say. And it makes yourself lose credibility. You can say all day long the defense looks good, and that's true because I went, and I'll tell you what I saw. I'll tell you my biggest takeaway of the two training camps that I've been to. It is so much more simple on the defensive side of the football. So much more simple. When we were in the indoor one, for the whole practice was indoors, I think it was from 6:30 to 9 or something. Because you know how training camp works for the Bucs for the most part, is how it mostly goes. You know, they warm up, do all their stretches together, and then, you know, the air horn rings, and then they start to do their individual position drills, which means, you know, the linebackers coach does some linebacker drills with the linebackers, then the defensive tackles, you know, so on and so forth. And I was looking, where I was sitting was the half of the field where the defense was. So I got a good look at them, which is good because the other practice I went to, I only saw the offense. So it was good that I got to see the defense too. And we all know that the defense is the worst part of the Achilles heel of this team, okay? So I'm looking at the defense, and we are doing these drills that are actually normal football drills. Normal drills. I mean, sometimes, like that you see on TV, like when you turn on NFL Network and they're doing the training camp coverage, and you see, you know, teams doing kind of similar drills, and then we're over here doing the most random stuff you've never seen before. We are actually doing normal drills now. And it's fantastic because I used to play football for about like 3 years, late elementary and then early to late middle school. And those were drills like we used to do. Like the, you know, you put a football at the end of a stick and you have the whole defensive line up, like all, because, you know, it's training camp. So you got like 90 people on the roster now. So you have like freaking 20 defensive linemen. A lot of them are going to be cut, but as of right now, you have that many people. And the coach stands in the middle. And, he will say hike, but then not move the ball because the drill is trying to see if the players are looking at the ball and not hearing the cadence. Because one thing you can ask Chris Baker about a few years ago, I mean, We are so bad at jumping off sides. It's horrible. We're so bad at penalties. So we need to be doing drills that are addressing penalties. And this is a big one. You have the whole team line up on one line. The coach stands across from him with the ball, and he says hike probably 800 times. And only on one of those times, he actually moves the ball, and you're supposed to jump. And then, and it's, you know, typical. If you jump too early, it's a penalty, and then you got to do your push-ups. And I'm like, this is a drill that is so simple, yet I've never seen us do it before, and it's fantastic. And even some of the defensive line drills where we work on our footwork and we're, you know, they're doing the chopping stuff and they're going in and out of the tackling dummies. Like, this is stuff that we need to be doing. These are normal drills and we're finally doing them. It was honestly eye-opening. I was like, wow. And do you know what's even better? The coaching staff actually looks like they care. Like, for instance, the best part about this year is that we didn't keep one coach. You're probably like, well, Will, every 3 years we fire every coach. That's true, but not everyone. We've kept the same special teams coach for like literally 10 years, and we've kept the same offensive line coach, I'm not kidding, for at least 8 years, 8 to 9 years. But this year, that's all new. And I'm looking about our special teams are absolutely horrible. So the fact that we've had such a bad coach for so long is, you know, typical. But now we have a new guy. And I'm looking at it, and I was smiling while watching practice because they were doing special teams practice. And the coach, after every play, he would get his little, you know, Microsoft Pro, like iPad thing. That's what it's called. This thing. The NFL is obsessed with them now. And every single play, after he would go right in the middle of a huddle, and he'd hold the. It looked like they were taking a selfie because it was actually kind of funny looking. He would hold the iPad up, and it would be the play. I mean, I can't see from where I'm sitting, or no fan could, but you would have to assume that it's the play that they're trying to do. And he's correcting where people are in the wrong positions. He's holding the iPad up. He points at people. He's like, "Hey, look, you're here. You need to be here. Look at the iPad. This is what the play's supposed to look like." And literally, we never did stuff like that before. You're probably, for some of you new Buck fans out there that are listening to this, you're probably like, "Yeah, like that's pretty normal for an NFL team." It's not for us. We're actually doing normal things, and we look better. And, you know, when somebody messes up, muffs a kick, does something, the coach just sprints out, and it's a real young coach that we have. Maybe not real young, maybe like 40s or 50s, but, you know, we just have these 80-year-old coaches that we used to have with Cutter and Lovey. I'm tired of them. So we have these young guys, or younger at least, and after someone messes up, he just runs right in the middle of the field, interrupts the play, and yells at the guy. And I'm like, where has this been? This has been needed for so long, and of course it's senior year. Of course it's my senior year when we start to act like a national football team. A professional football team. Of course it's my senior year. And I'm hoping we can correct somehow, have some like massive correction this year, and we can go to the playoffs. And I just want to go to one playoff game before I go to college. Can we just, for one time, I've had season tickets for forever. I've been going to games for so long, and I've never had the opportunity to go to a playoff game. And it would just make my year, my college send-off, if I could just attend a playoff game at home. But, you know, we got to be realistic now with the schedule they gave us. We have 7 weeks with no home game. I mean, it's ridiculous, but whatever. So we're starting to run normal drills. And now I'm going to start. So I saw the defense, and we're doing normal stuff. And another thing was before they gotten onto, like, the 11-on-11 team practices and stuff, they're still doing kind of like they kind of brought all the defense. They were done with the individual position drills. Now they're just doing offensive and defensive drills. Offense on the other side of the field, defense on my side of the field, and they're just kind of playing against each other. And I'm not kidding. When they would practice, you know, blitzing and all that stuff, which we'll get into in a minute, because blitzing looks fantastic. But we'll get into that in a minute. And since they're not practicing with the offense right now, normally, you know, they just kind of do walkthroughs and stuff. But I ain't even kidding with you guys right now. We have Byron Leftwich, who's the offensive coordinator. And he used to be an NFL quarterback. I couldn't identify. I think it might have been the special teams coach, but it doesn't really matter. that guy's playing the running back, and they're playing each other. And then another one of the coaches was the center. Like, the coaches are literally playing with them. And I don't mean that in, like, oh, they're playing with them. Like, they're actually, like, practicing with them. They're like, okay, so you need to be blitzing from this gap. You need to be blitzing from this gap. And you, the edge rushers need to be going out here. And we're going to do, we need to practice our outside running plays. So instead of just saying, okay, let's do a walkthrough, the coaches actually line up side by side with the players. And a coach is actually a running back. And he gets popped a little bit. Not like, you know, like as hard as they had hit each other, but like he takes a little pop. And I'm like, these are some coaches that actually care about their football team. It was really a good sight to see. I really liked it. Now, what everyone's been talking about, because no one's going to see what I just said will not be talked about in any newspaper, any article online. It'll only be talked about right here on Bucs Planet, because that's what I do. I talk about things no one's talking about, because those are the things that need to be talked about. Now, we'll get into what everyone's talking about, the 11-on-11 drills. This is what's been reported. Defense is harassing the offense. Jameis is throwing a bunch of picks. Blaine Gabbert's horrible. That's the report. Now, I'll tell you what's true, what's not true, and what I saw. Jameis Winston is throwing a bunch of picks. Partially true. But you have to remember, Byron Leftwich, offensive coordinator, remember, former NFL quarterback, came out and he said that they are purposely giving Jameis Winston the hardest looks possible in an NFL game in training camp right now. So he can make the mistakes now, learn from them, and then if they happen in a real game, if he gets the similar hard coverages like that in a real game, he'll understand. Now that sounds like that's fantastic news in my opinion. And I think that's very good coaching. But of course, what is the clickbait bias Tampa Bay Times? Oh, Jameis is throwing picks, we should have cut him. No, he's throwing picks because we're giving him hard coverages for the first time ever, because our other soft coaches like Cutter and Lovie Smith never gave him coverages like this, and this is why he struggles. But now that he's getting good coaching, he's getting a little bit of tough love here. And yeah, you can look at the interceptions and say that it's bad, or you can look at him and say he's learning from them, and that's what I think. The defense is harassing the offense. 100%, without a doubt, completely false. That's just false. Maybe that happened when that one idiot who just went there, because, I mean, if you can go to a training camp, okay, if you went to the two I went to, and what you got away from that training camp was that the defense is harassing the offense, like, that is just false. I saw it myself. Now, I'll tell you where it looked good. The blitzing looks really, really good. And maybe this is part of what I saw, because what would have been a sack in a real game, they kind of let go and they just let the offense finish the play. So it looks like the defense isn't getting there and it looks like there's people wide open. That could be the case. But it's not always the case. The blitzing looks fantastic. Devin White is so fast. Like, I look at this guy, it's like, oh, he's there. Oh, no. And my eyes are constantly, this guy, he's smaller than I expected. He's very short, but he is very muscular and he's really fast. And he can just zoom right past the offensive line, which, again, it's where our offensive line, I just read, was ranked 32nd. Which, let's get into that for a second, too. The offensive line. Okay, do you know what I get sick and tired of? If you think that Jameis Winston is, like, just, you know, trash and garbage, and then, like, all of it's his fault, like, that is an invalid opinion. Like, people say, oh, you can't have wrong opinions. Yes, you can, because that opinion is wrong. I want you to understand, when I start, you know, listing stats of how Deshaun Watson and Jameis are similar, and then do you know what I get every single time in response? Oh, Deshaun Watson has a bad offensive line. He can't do anything. Well, don't you know that? Oh, well, interesting, because I read three articles. Texans offensive line is ranked 27th. So is that good? No. Do you know what the Bucs offensive line on average is ranked? 31st. It was ranked 32nd in two articles and 30th in one article. And in every article, it was lower than the Texans' offensive line. So I don't want to hear any garbage about why Deshaun Watson gets every excuse in the world for being inaccurate and having all these problems, because of his offensive line. It's absurd. Jameis has a worse offensive line, worse coaching, because Bill O'Brien's been with the Texans for a long time. That doesn't mean that he's necessarily a good coach, but if you've been around for that long, that means you're doing something right and you're kind of good at your job. I think it's been 8 seasons or something crazy like that. Like, Jameis has had absolute garbage. I mean, imagine having Lovie Smith as your coach. Like, you just get drafted to a football team. Okay, you're the number one pick, and your head coach is Lovie Smith. That is a guaranteed year down the drain. So, in my opinion, Jameis has played 3 NFL seasons because that's a year down the drain. And then you have a coaching change in your first year as a quarterback. So then you have to go, and even though they promoted Cutter to be from the offensive coordinator to be the head coach, I mean, like, it's still mostly the same offense, but it's still a whole new system you got to learn again. So now it's like, okay. And then let me mind you this also. If you think Marcus Mariota is a better quarterback than Jameis Winston, you are completely wrong. And I watch videos and people, like, you know, the idiots, because we have a lot of idiots out here. We had a lot of them that are on ESPN and all these talk shows, and they keep saying how Mariota's better, and they keep referencing the playoff stat. Yeah, it's important for you to go to the playoffs, but I want you to understand the Titans, on average, have had a top 10 ranked defense every year Mariota's been there, I think. And at worst, they're ranked 12th. Do you know what the Bucs defense is ranked? If it's anything higher than 30th, it's a good defensive year for us because we suck. I mean, we were on pace at week 7 last year to give up the most yardage of any defense in NFL history. That means we were on pace to be the worst defense in NFL history. Put Mariota on our team. By the way, Mariota's had a great offensive line. Not really his first year, but when they drafted Conklin and all those other guys that they've signed and stuff, he has a good offensive line. Jameis has a horrible offensive line, horrible defense, and then horrible coaching. I mean, Cutter is clearly not a head coach. I mean, you have to give him I'm not kidding. I give Jameis 2 to 3 more years at least. At least. Unless he just comes out and looks absolutely dreadful, terrible this year, and like we somehow get the number one pick to pick Tua or something. Like, I honestly think Jameis still has a chance. I mean, he's had horrible coaching, horrible offensive line. Now, I'm not just making excuses for him because some of it is his fault, but, I mean, he's had so much bad come his way. Off the field thing, sure, his fault. You know, some of the boneheaded interceptions, sure, his fault. But, I mean, let's be honest here. The Bucs suck. And they're not very good at football, and he didn't come into the greatest of situations. It's irritating because you're like, it's been 4 years and he's not showing anything, but I'd still give him a chance. I really would. I really would. I honestly want to see him again next year, like this season and then next season. I mean, guaranteed. Because Arians doesn't want to start over. He's 66 years old. You think he wants to just draft some young guy and he's just going to win a bunch of games eventually in like 10 years? Like, no, we want to win now. That's what he said. We're winning now. Okay, we got semi off track, but I just want to talk about that. So we were talking about the defensive blitzing, which it looks good. It looks really good, and I'm actually really excited to see that in action this year. I think it could help a lot. Now, I'll also say that when they do the 7-on-7s, which for you guys that don't know, for the most part, it's just a quarterback, 4 wide receivers, and a tight end. And then you have like 6 defensive backs, 1 safety, and then 1-on-1 with everyone else. And it's just basically a wide receiver defensive back drill. That's basically what it is. And then slightly a quarterback drill. And I can tell you one thing, we were covering really, really well. I was impressed. Hargraves looked decent, but he still doesn't look that good. I mean, he's a bust at this point. Like, he is such a bust. But, you know, Whitehead made some plays. We have that rookie, Mike Edwards from Kentucky, safety. He has looked real good. Whitehead's looked good. Carlton Davis. They're all covering well when they do those one-on-one drills. I'm impressed with our man coverage, and I think our technique's better, and we seem to be covering better. So I like that. What was concerning? The offense ran some red zone drills. This was when we were getting now into what I call the 11 on 11. And they originally put the ball at the 20 and said, okay, it's fourth and goal, score. Okay? And then after that, they moved it up to the 15, and then they did the 15 again, then they did the 10, then they did the 5, and they just kind of alternated between the 15, 10, and 5 for the most part. And the offense, and you had one chance to score. It's not like you're at the 5 or you're at the 10 and you throw an incompletion and then it's like, okay, you get to do it again. No, like it's like that was your chance, and then they move the ball somewhere else. Okay? The offense scored 9 out of 10 tries in the red zone on one play. That is unacceptable. The defense looked so good in the drills. It looked good on the 7-on-7. And then they just went down to the 11-on-11 red zone drills, and they looked completely lost. It was just like Mike Smith's defense again. Now, this is training camp, so this is where you want to look lost. But I'm just tired of the, oh, it looks fantastic. It looks like literal garbage. 9 out of 10 tries. And it wasn't even just with the first team. Because originally, if you know how training camp works, it's always first team offense versus first team defense. And then after Jameis went 3 for 3 in the red zone, they put in the second team with Blaine Gabbert at quarterback. And then they put in the second team defense. And that offense went 3 for 3. And then the third string went 2 for 3. Like, it was just, what is happening? The defense looks horrible. And they're going from all different yards, from the 15, from the 10, to the 5. They score on every play except one. That was just thrown away because no one was open. It was good coverage. Like, that's bad. Wouldn't you say that's bad? I would say that's bad. Blaine Gabbert looks, I don't think he looks that good at all, if I'm going to be honest. I thought they should have given Ryan Griffin a chance to be the backup quarterback. And I know he hasn't played a game yet, but he looks good in preseason. I know it's just preseason, but he looks good in it. He's been with us for 3 years now. Give him a chance. Like, come on. Well, Blaine Gabbert's got experience. Yeah, he has experience, but it's bad experience. He's horrible. I hope that it's kind of an open-ended backup spot right now, that Griffin and Gabbert are competing for it instead of it just being Gabbert right now. But I'll trust what Arians does, I guess. I would just like to see the young kid Griffin get a chance to be the backup. Yeah. So, training camp, it's interesting. It's good to kind of see where your team is at. It's very interesting this year. If you haven't gone, if you're like, oh, it's the same thing every year, why should I go? I would go this year. It actually is kind of different this year. In terms of, like, just sitting there and being hot and when it's outside or, like, whatever, it's the same. But in terms of, like, what you're watching, like, every drill is, like, kind of different. And the coaches are real involved, and they're, you know, yelling at players. They have iPads in people's faces showing what they need to be doing. It's good. It's good. It's what our team needs. So, for predictions, again, none, because we have our first preseason game. We haven't even played our first preseason game. It's this Friday against the Pittsburgh Steelers at the Steelers. Looking forward to watching that. See, that's a good test, because hopefully Ben Roethlisberger plays and they have the whole first team Steelers versus the whole first team, our first team defense. So, because Steelers are known for their high-powered offense. I know they lost Antonio Brown, but whatever. Still a high-powered offense. And Le'Veon Bell, but still a high-powered offense. And that's a good test for our first-team defense. So I hope that I get to see that matchup just for maybe a drive or two. Because, you know, the starting people only really stay in for a quarter. So I think that's going to be, if you guys are sitting there and you're like, I don't like to watch preseason, like whatever. If you're going to watch it, this is what you got to watch for. The first-team Steelers offense versus our first-team defense to see if the defense has really cracked up what it needs to be. I would watch to see how our first-team offenses ran, because apparently, I don't know if you heard this, but Arian said that he doesn't believe in running backs blocking, which I found very concerning because our offensive line sucks and we need a running back to help block. But apparently Arians doesn't believe in that, and Jameis is going to have to throw the ball really fast. And Arians likes to have like a deep passing offense, so not really sure how it's going to work, but there's definitely going to be some kinks and errors. One thing that I will say that's interesting about this season that I'm really, really, really looking forward to is I was watching the Hall of Fame game, whenever that was, last Thursday or Friday something, I don't know, and there was a pass interference play. And do you know what the announcers immediately started saying? I wonder if the Broncos are going to challenge the pass interference. And I'm just sitting there and I'm like, oh my gosh, I forgot about that. You can challenge pass interference this year and it's going to be great. It's going to be fantastic. It actually might blow up in my face, but it's going to be interesting. Like whatever you say, it's going to be interesting. And I'm kind of, it's a 1-year trial run. See if they like it. But I think it's fair to hold the refs accountable for their horrible calls. And you can challenge pass interference. Like, this is actually kind of insane. Like, this is something that you would dream about. It's actually going to happen. But look, I'm not going to be like a pass interference challenge fanboy. Like, if it starts to get abused, like people keep challenging Hail Marys and stuff, like, I'm going to support getting rid of it. But I do think that it's fair to challenge what a ref calls. When a ref calls a penalty and you can say, hey, that's not a penalty, and then they can review it. I think that's fair. I almost think they should extend it to more penalties. I know it would take the game longer, but I'd rather have a clean called game than a butchered Rams Saints game again. But it's going to be good. You can shout. And they also said something interesting. If there's holding, because they're like, one time they called a play, it was defensive holding, like the cornerback held the wide receiver. And the announcer's like, but you can't challenge that, right? And the other guy who's I think they're talking to the head of officiating or something, he said, no, you actually can challenge that because what you can do is you can challenge to say that holding was actually pass interference and then they can call pass interference spot of the foul. And I was like, oh, that's interesting. I don't know if I like that or not, but that's kind of interesting. So, yeah. I'm just excited about the Bucs Planet podcast. I'm excited for this season. It's been a long off season. I've just been so bored. What am I gonna do? Like, football is so much fun to watch. I love it. College football. I love college football too. It's my senior year in high school. I want to enjoy my last season ticket year with the Bucs for at least a while. And yeah, that's gonna do it for the first episode of the new Bucs Planet podcast. And remember, keep watching, like the video. And it's going to be a wild ride this year, boys. But it's going to be fun. See you guys next time.